Today's session, we would be learning the preparation of subsidiary books. We saw that there are eight subsidiary books. The eight subsidiary books are purchase book, sales book, purchase return, sales return, bills receivable, bills payable, journal proper. And we also saw that each of these subsidiary books, it is used for recording a specific type of transaction. Then now we would be learning how to go about with the preparation of these subsidiary books. Okay, so as a part of the first question, we would be learning the preparation of purchase, sales, purchase return, and sales return subsidiary books. Okay, so we would be learning the preparation of these four subsidiary books, and let me show the question here for you. Enter the following transaction in the sales purchase, sales return, purchase return, subsidiary books of ABC Limited for 2020. So we would be preparing all these four. Subsidiary books, and let me quickly display the transactions here for you. So there are four. Subsidiary books that we have to prepare for this particular question, and then we would also be discussing how to go about passing the entries into the subsidiary books. So please remember, preparation of transactions into subsidiary books is slightly different from that of journals. Okay, how you go about entering transactions into subsidiary book is slightly different as to how we were carrying out in the case of journals. So we have around 10 transactions, and please remember, these transaction, it corresponds to ABC Limited, and let us go about with the preparation of these transactions into these four subsidiary books. Okay, so dear students, in this question, we would be preparing four subsidiary books. The four subsidiary books that we would be preparing are purchase book, sales book, purchase return book, sales return book. When we were learning the conventional system of accounting, we learned how to prepare journal, and then we learned how to prepare ledger. So in that scenario, we were preparing the journal, and then we, as a part of the ledger, we were preparing the various accounts. Please remember, over here, what we are preparing is the subsidiary books. Okay, so each by itself is a separate book. Okay, so I'm pretty sure you must all be having an understanding that when we prepare journals, we would be preparing a separate book. So likewise, for each of these subsidiary books, we will be having an individual book. Okay, so we will be having one book for purchase, we will be having another book for sales, we will be having another book for purchase return, we will be having another book for sales return. So each of this will correspond to a specific type of transaction. Okay, each of these subsidiary book will correspond to a specific type of transaction. Now, let us quickly visit the format. Okay, let us quickly visit the format. The first is your date. We record, use date column for recording the date of the transaction. Then you have particulars. Then you have the particulars column. This is the place where you'd be recording or you'd be writing down the details of your transaction. Then you have invoice, then ledger folio. Then you have the details amount. So it can so happen that there may be some, the transaction may have some breakup. Okay, so when we discuss this particular question, you will be understanding the use of this column better. Then you have the amount column. Now, at this point of time, I just want to clarify the column, which is called as invoice. Now, what is meant by invoice? I'm pretty sure we all must have had an experience when we went prior to lockdown, when we walked into a supermarket, we would pick up all that we want. And then while we're walking out at the cash counter, we would showcase all the things that we bought. The person would scan the barcode, and then they would say, this is such and such is the total amount. You make the payment and the person would generate a bill. Okay. Now, if you closely examine the bill has, each bill is unique. How do you know each bill is unique? Because each bill will have a unique bill number. Okay? Each bill will have a unique bill number. So when you examine the bill in detail, you would see that the details of the transaction that has been carried out would be mentioned over there. What was the date? What is the product that you have bought? Does the product have any serial numbers? So, for example, if you end up buying some electronic goods, what would happen is there would be some reference numbers, there would be some serial numbers. Those would be mentioned. Then the amount would be mentioned. Then in certain cases, the mode of payment. Did you pay using cash? Did you pay using card? Did you pay using UPI? So the modes of payment would also be mentioned over there. So that is what is called as an invoice. That is what is called as an invoice. So whenever you purchase something from a supplier, they would be giving you a bill. So that bill number you would record over here. Whenever you sell your products to the customer, you would be giving them a bill. You would be giving that person the bill. So that bill number would get recorded over here. Now, another thing that you have to notice is when it comes to purchase return and sales return, you will have what is called as debit note and credit note. So these are two documents which are used as a part of the accounting process whenever you carry out purchase return and sales return. So here's the deal. Some of us may have had some experience buying certain products online, let's say Flipkart or Amazon. And in certain cases, what can happen is we're not happy with a product and we may, you know, raise a return. And then someone will come for the pickup. So when the pickup is completed, they will give you a reference document. They will give you a reference document. So basically that reference document corresponds to your debit note and your credit note. That will correspond to your debit note and your credit note. So it confirms that you have carried out a return. So that document is called as your debit note and your credit note. Then in certain textbooks, the format of purchase return and sales return is slightly different. They may not have the details column. They may not have the details column. So just in case, if you refer to some of those kind of textbooks, please do not be alarmed. It is quite natural. Okay, it is quite natural that you may those textbooks, they may have missed out or they may have omitted these two columns. So in certain cases, you may not have the details column. Okay, now let's go about with the entry of transactions into these four subsidiary books. Let's look at the transactions one by one. So please remember, we are preparing the books of accounts for ABC Limited, and what we are preparing over here is subsidiary book. Okay, what we are preparing over here is subsidiary book, and we know that all these transactions, it corresponds to 2020. Okay, all these transactions correspond to 2020. So let us make a note, 2020. Okay, now let's look at the first transaction. Sold 10 shirts to Tony at 500 rupees each and bought from Hari 5 ties at 100 each. Okay, so there are two transactions that are taking place on Jan 1st. The first transaction is that you're selling shirts. So selling shirts, you're selling 10 shirts and each shirt corresponds to 500 rupees. So how do you go about with the entry? Jan 1st, okay, Jan 1st. Here, you would just write the name of the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction. So you're carrying out with Tony. So I'm just gonna write Tony here. Just going to write Tony here. Notice how we are processing the entries in subsidiary books is very different from how we were processing entries into journals. Okay, how we are processing entries into subsidiary books is very different from how we are processing entries into journals. So in the case of subsidiary books, all that you just have to do is you just have to write the name of the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction. And what were the details? You are purchasing 10 shirts, okay, and you are buying this at 500 rupees. Okay, you're buying this at 500 rupees. Okay, so you bought 10 shirts and each of them corresponds to 500. Okay, now you could write this in details column also. So 10 into rupees 500. Okay, 10 into, so details column is used for writing down the breakup of the transaction. Okay, the breakup of the transaction. So 10 into 500, how much does that correspond to? This corresponds to 5,000. Okay, this corresponds to 5,000. This corresponds to 5,000. So you bought 10 shirts, 500 rupees, it corresponds to 5,000. Okay, so we have completed half of the transaction for Jan 1st. Now let's look at the second half. Second half is that you have bought from Hari. Okay, you have bought from Hari. The second half is that you have bought from Hari. Now, what is it that you're buying from Hari? Hari, you're buying five ties. Okay, from Hari, you're buying five ties. So what is that? That is a purchase. Okay, that is a purchase. So purchase, where would you record? You would record this in purchase subsidiary book. Okay, purchase, you would record into purchase subsidiary book. Remember, how do we process the entry? You just have to write the name of the person. You just have to write the name of the person. And what is the name of the person? The name of the person is Hari. And what are you doing? You're buying five ties. You're buying five ties, and each of the tie is worth 100 rupees. Okay, now let's get the breakup. 5 into rupees 100, and that works out to be 500. Okay, that works out to be 500. So if you would notice, passing entries into subsidiary books is really quick. It is really fast. And unlike your journal, you don't have to write to, you don't have to write by, you just have to write the name of the person. So this is the reason why subsidiary book preparation is referred to as practical system of accounting. Okay, it is referred to as practical system of accounting. Okay, now let's move on. The next transaction that we have is on Jan 2nd. Tony returned two shirts. Okay, Tony returned two shirts. So remember, for Tony to return two shirts to you, what should Tony do? You should have sold something to Tony. So Jan 2nd, let's see, what is the transaction? Tony returned two shirts. So here again, Tony, you just have to write the name of the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction. So the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction is Tony. Okay? The name of the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction is Tony. And how many shirts is Tony returning? Tony is returning two shirts. So let's mention the details. And remember, at what rate did we sell the shirts to Tony? So we sold at 500 rupees. So 2 into 500, this total works out to be 1,000 rupees. Okay, this total works out to be 1,000 rupees. Now let's look at the next one, Jan 2nd. Okay, let's look at the next one, Jan 2nd. Sold 20 trousers to Asif at 800 rupees. Okay, sold 20 trousers to Asif at 800 rupees each. So how do we write this transaction? We write this transaction by, so this will be a sale. Okay, so you go to Jan 2nd, okay, and you have to write down the name of the person with whom you carry out. You're carrying this out with Asif. And what is it that you have told? You have sold 20 trousers, and each of the trouser corresponds to 800 rupees. So that is done. So 20 into rupees 800, this works out to be 16,000 rupees. Okay, this works out to be 16,000 rupees. So we are done with the transaction on Jan 2nd. Okay. Now let's look at Jan 3rd. Asif returned two trousers. Okay. So which means this is the sales return. So Jan 3rd, okay. We have to write the name of the person. And what is Asif returning? Asif is returning two trousers. Remember, at what rate did we sell? We sold at 800. So this works out to be 1,600. Okay, now let's move on. The next one is Jan 4th. Jan 4th, the transaction is purchased five shirts from Kushal. Okay, the transaction on Jan 4th is purchased five shirts from Kushal. So what kind of a transaction is this? This transaction is a purchase transaction. So which subsidiary book would that go to? That will go into your purchase subsidiary book. So Jan 4th, okay, the transaction is, from whom are you purchasing? You're purchasing from Kushal. So you just have to write the name of the person with whom you're carrying out the transaction. That is Kushal. And let's give the breakup, the details. You're buying five shirts, okay, and each of the shirt is worth 600 rupees. So 5 into rupees 600, and that works out to be 3,000 rupees. So Jan 4th transaction is completed. Jan 5th, return one shirt to Kushal. Okay, so what is happening over here? We purchased something from Kushal and we are not happy with that product. Now we are returning it. So what kind of a return is that? This would be a purchase return. So Jan 5th, what will happen is Kushal, okay, and how many shirts are we returning? We are returning one shirt. And at what amount? Rupees 600. So this works out to be 600 rupees. Okay, this works out to be 600 rupees. Next one, Jan 6th, Matthew bought three shirts for cash. Okay, Matthew bought three shirts for cash. So what kind of a transaction is this? This is a sale transaction. See, Matthew is buying. So if Matthew has to buy from us, what should we do? We have to sell to Matthew. If Matthew has to buy from us, we have to sell to Matthew. But how do we sell? How are we selling this to Matthew? We are selling for cash. So should we record this in these four subsidiary books? Yes or no? The answer is no. Why? Because it is the cash sale. Since it is the cash sale, where would you record the transaction? You would record the transaction in cash book. So in your questions, they may give you transactions like this to confuse you, to test your understanding, to see are you sound with your fundamentals. So should we record this here? We should not be recording it here. Why? Because it is a cash sale. Since it is a cash sale, the transaction should be reflecting in the cash book, not in a sale book, not in a sales subsidiary book, because sales subsidiary book we are using only for recording credit transactions. Okay, so we would not be recording it over here. Jan 7th, Lakshmi bought 5 ties for rupees 150 each. Okay, so Jan 7th, it is a sale for us. So we have to write the name. It is Lakshmi. And then Lakshmi's, what are we selling to Lakshmi? We are selling 5 ties. And each time we are selling at 150 rupees. So 5 into rupees 150, this works out to be 750. Okay, this works out to be, the total works out to be 750. So that was pretty easy. Now let's look at the next transaction, Jan 8. Okay, I want all of you to pay attention to the transaction on Jan 8. Bought 20 shirts from Thomas. Bought 20 shirts from Thomas. So what is happening over here? We are buying some shirts from Thomas. Okay, and also Thomas gave a trade discount of 10%. Thomas gave us a trade discount of 10%. So what is meant by trade discount? See, there are two kinds of discounts that you can have. You can have what is called as cash discount, and then you can have trade discount. So trade discount is the discount that you give while the transaction is being carried out. Now, to motivate the person to pay up the money, you may offer what is called as a cash discount. Okay, so in this case, it is not a cash discount, it is a trade discount. So what will happen is that we have to calculate the discount instantly. Okay, we will have to calculate the discount instantly. So now let us look at this. We are buying something from Thomas. So what are we buying from Thomas? From Thomas, we are buying 20 shirts. From Thomas, we are buying 20 shirts. And we saw that each of these shirts is worth, we are buying 20 shirts, and each of these shirts are worth 500 rupees. Okay, so how much is the total amount? So 20 into 500. So this works out to be, okay, so this, so 20 into 500, when you calculate this, this works out to be 10,000. So 20 into rupees 500, we see that this works out to be rupees 10,000. Okay, now also, he's giving us a discount. So less discount. Now discount is how much? discount is 10%, but 10% of what? 10% of the amount. So 10% of the amount is 1,000 rupees. Okay. So 10,000 minus 1,000, the total amount works out to be 9,000. So likewise, if you have any kind of calculation that needs to be carried out, those breakups, those computations, you would be able to carry out using the details column. Okay? So those calculations need to be carried out in your details column. So the total amount works out to be 9,000. Now, let's look at the next one. Sold, okay, so Jan 9th, sold 10 shirts to Hari at rupees 750 and allowed him a discount of 10%. So what are we doing over here? We are carrying out a sale. Okay? And to whom are we carrying out a sale? We are carrying out a sale to Hari. Okay? We are carrying out a sale to Hari. And what are we doing? We are selling 10 shirts. And each of these shirts is worth 750. Okay? Each of the shirt is worth 750. And 750. So how much does the total work out to be? So 10 into rupees 750, this is 7,500. Okay, this is 7,500. Then less discount. So discount is at what rate? Discount is at 10%. So 10% is how much? 750. Okay, so discount is how much? 750. So the total works out to be 6,250. The total works out to be 6,250. So I hope by now all of you are clear with the purpose of details column. So details column we would be using to carry out any kind of calculations or computations of this man. Now let's look at the last transaction. Sold to Matthew one trouser for. Okay, I think I've made a small mistake with the amount over here. So I think this should be 6,750. This should be 6,750. So I think I made a small mistake with the amount. It should be 6,750. Okay, so moving on, let's look at the last transaction. Sold to Matthew one trouser, rupees 1,500 for cash. Again, this is the transaction given to us to confuse us. Okay, this is a transaction given to us to confuse us. Please remember, it is a cash sale, and cash sale we would not be recording in a subsidiary book, because subsidiary book is used only for recording our credit transactions. Okay, so I think we are done, and what we can do right now is we can total up. Okay, we have to write the total. So let us calculate the total. Total for purchase is 12,500. Okay, let's look at the total for sales. Total for sales is 18,500. And let's look at the sale total for purchase return, 600, and total here is 2,600. So with that, we have completed the subsidiary book of ABC, and we have processed those 10 transactions that we were asked to do. Okay? We have completed preparation of subsidiary book for purchase, sales, purchase return, sales return for the 10 transactions of ABC Limited.